Want to welcome everyone this morning, those that are online or listening as well. It's just a beautiful morning. The weather, wow, this is real Iowa weather now, isn't it? I love it. So it can change though real quick. So just a welcome to everyone, and hope you all are here with the attitude of worship. I had to think, I read a little article about some of the early printings of the song books, and I think, how many of you, when you walk in, when you come to church, do you even think about the fact that you have a song book to sing out of? I don't hardly ever think about it much. But back before the 15th century, there weren't hardly any. They didn't have them. And I found this before in the early days of the Reformation, owning certain books printed by Anabaptists was risky, even to the point of death. In 1551, an Anabaptist was printing Men of Simon's literature when the authorities discovered the underground printing operation. They uncovered 10 tons of books in 1544. Printer Jan Clace, an Anabaptist baptized by Simons, was beheaded for having in his ownership 600 copies of Menas printings. It cost him his life to have those books. And we don't think about that. And the Ausbund, and the printings of this forbidden book in the early Anabaptist movement, and that is the Ausbund, is a real thick book that many of the Amish churches use to sing out of. Now, I understand, I think I'm right, that here in this community, they use a thin, just a little book. Am I right with that? I don't think they used the big Ausbund. But where I grew up, those communities, they use, it's a big, thick book. And it's different than what, a little different than what this little one that they use in this area. And that was one, that book was written by people that were actually the first 51 songs in that book were written by prisoners that were in some castle for quite a few years, like 5 years, and then later they were martyred for their faith. But they wrote a bunch of those. And this book has its roots in the very founding of Anabaptism. The fifth and sixth hymn in that Ausbund were written by Anabaptist leaders George Blaurock and Felix Mons. And I have a verse of it. I have one verse here, is all I have for it. And it says, "Merciful are you, O Lord, and good. Graciously you may be found. Whoever does your will here on earth, you acknowledge as your children." I thought that was pretty good. And then it's also in the German. And the first line, verse goes, "Gnädig bist du, O Herr, und gut." It's merciful are you, O Lord, and good. And I think it's very good verse there. But then later, not shortly after that, he was burned at the stake in trial in 1529, a martyr for his faith. So he wrote this song, and soon after he was martyred, burned at the stake. So do we take for granted our songbooks, our songs that we sing? We might say those are written in blood. A lot of those are. And I know it made me think a little bit. So often I take it for granted. I don't think about it, that those people suffered greatly to write these songs. And they were written from their heart. So let's pray. God, we thank you this morning again for your love and mercy, and we know you are a good God. But your mercy is also very, very great. And we are able to be recipients of that, and we can experience that. And we thank you this morning for that privilege again. And Lord, I pray as we gather here this morning, as we worship you, and as we sing your songs, your words, may we take those to heart and be mindful of what you have done and what people have suffered years and years ago to write these. And we know that you have put those in their hearts, those songs, those words, to write them. And so we are grateful this morning. We just again thank you for the privilege of being in your house to serve you and to worship you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, if any of you have any announcements, we have a mic back there for whoever may have an announcement. So, Kenton.
Thought I would announce this. This coming Wednesday evening, I think the youth group is maybe, or some of them coming over to our place to help do some cleanup, and I thought I could open that up for others. If anyone else wants to come, probably have some demolition, removing drywall, raking leaves, sticks, different things. We'll have try to have a trailer there that can be loaded with debris. Parking is somewhat limited, so keep that in mind. Don't feel like you need to come, but I know some of you have been asking about ways of helping, so we're thinking maybe 6 o'clock and later. Doesn't have to be real late, but a couple of hours or something. If anybody wants to come, they'd be welcome. The address is 801 12th Avenue in Wellman. That is, if you go north by the cafe up to 9th Street and turn west and follow it until you get to the end of the road, that's, we're just across from there. So, thank you.
Thank you, Kenton. So there's not an age limit, huh? You might want to, before you go, you might want to talk to Jenny about the snake, so I won't say any more. They're friendly, though. It didn't hurt anybody. If you notice, if you read your bulletin, if you are at all interested in going to convention, to BMA convention this summer, it's a good idea to register early because of where it's at. It's going to be limited, or a lot of tourists, it's in the tourist season and all that, so it's very important to get registered early, or you may have to pitch a tent somewhere. So do that early if you're at all interested in going. Also, for the service this evening, it's a Mother's Day program, and I think it'll be really interesting. It's a tribute to mothers, so be sure to be here. I think it's worth our time to be here for that. Be interesting to see what they got planned for that. So, if no one else has anything, I will turn the time over to Mel and Sharon.
Good morning. Good to have all of you here. Our Lord gave us the Great Commission. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. While we're not all preachers or even teachers, we can all be witnesses to those around us of our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord, and with joy and gladness, faithfully share the good news. Let's start with number 350 in our hymnal, A Charge to Keep I Have.
I have a charge to keep.
for Jesus. Count your blessings.
Count your blessings in divine love.
We'll work till Jesus comes. Oh,
thank you, Mel and Sharon. We'll work till Jesus comes. I don't know if you ever think of it or not, but sometimes I think it seems like it's so close that why do we start another project? Jesus is coming anyway. I don't know. Maybe I'm the only one that thinks that. But I know that he also said, work till I come. And that's what that song's saying. So let's keep on until Jesus comes. Thank you for those songs. I'd like to pray for our offering this morning, and it's for church expenses and Camp Deer Park. So let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning again for the blessings of supplying us with enough money that we can share with others. And I pray as we give to this cause for the church, for the grounds, keeping the grounds, and expenses that we need, that we have here. We ask that you would bless these funds and that we could use them in a godly and wise way. Also pray for the Sunday school offering for Camp Deer Park and the work they do there. And give them wisdom on how to use that wisely, and that you would bless those funds as well. So we thank you, and just thank you for giving us your grace and your love as we share with others. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, it is open for sharing, introductions for visitors, and see what the Lord has laid on your heart this morning. So we have a mic to go around, so those that are listening online, on phone or online, can hear it as well. So, Sharon.
We finally got to the Ped Mall again. We thought we wouldn't. Friday was supposed to rain right when we're supposed to go, but the weather forecast changed a few hours before that, and it was a very busy day. And one gentleman, whose name is Eric, which rings a bell because one of our sons is Eric, and he's his same age, he was sharing with us about many, many things, and we were showing some of our videos we have in that. One's on homosexuality as far as that issue, and we have one on abortion. He said, oh, that's a hot topic. That would not be well received. And then we talked about many things, and one thing really convicted me. He said, as far as the race issues, it won't be over till we do not say, well, that Chinese man, that black man, that red man, and we just say that man. I thought, uh-oh, I have been guilty. You know, am I trying to brag when I say this was a black man that we ministered to today? You know, I thought, oh boy, I have a little ways to go yet. But we had a couple from Tennessee take a couple large print Bibles, and she said, oh, I will be now really enjoying reading my Bible because I could finally see well. Mm-hmm. And just a lot of people took things. Someone, young woman took a love and respect book, and it was wonderful to be there on Friday.
Thank you, Sharon. Blessings to you as you go and minister there at the mall. Anna Fern.
Yes, I have a note from Ellie. I'm going to read this just as she had it. I'm wondering if you would know of anyone from our church or community that would be interested in a 2-year commitment as a pastoral couple here at Kurdistan. Maybe this need has already been made known at the church, but I wonder if there's someone who is feeling the call and hasn't made the step to come yet. Are there any married couples you can think of that might be considering an opportunity like this? Would it be helpful to tap some shoulders? A few things kind of pertaining to that. Her housemate that went home here a month or two ago is not coming back. She ended her time there. And the temporary couple that had been there for a couple months is leaving in June. There is a single fella there, and they are both taking, the single fella and her are both taking language class, but he may be moving to another town. The board does not want to bring another single couple in until they have a couple there to give some leadership. And after that, she would be there alone on the team. She is not sure what the future holds. The future is very uncertain, but she really has a vision and a passion for this work. So just keep praying for a couple to come. On the other note, her jaw is not any better or any worse. It bothers her when she chews or talks a lot or sings or something like that. So we have some things to pray about here.
Thank you, Anna Fern. Thank you for that update and the requests there. Emma.
We plan to leave Thursday night and drive to Chicago to get on the plane to go to El Salvador to visit my sister-in-law who lost my brother as her husband the first part of March. And I'm having some physical problems myself, and I just want you all to pray for me that I will have the strength to enjoy my time on this trip. Thank you.
Thank you, Emma. We will be praying for that here in a little bit.
Yeah, Marlon. I just thought about it when we sang that last song, "We'll Work Till Jesus Comes." And usually at the end of our MDS meetings, that song was sung.
Is that
I
right?
Don't remember ever hearing sung here in this church before. Might have, but we used to hear that a lot. But we have with us now Ned and Marcella Graber from Red Lake, Canada. Ned is Nancy's brother, mm-hmm. And we enjoy having him. Thank you.
Thank you, Marlon, and welcome, Ned and your wife there. We appreciate having visitors. Richard.
Yeah, I don't know. I suppose most of you have heard about it. My oldest brother, he was in the hospital for a while, and they did some tests and discovered he does have lymphoma cancer, which doesn't sound good. It isn't good in our way of looking at it, but they actually started chemo just the other day, so I guess he's strong enough that they can start that, because that can tear your body down. So just pray that things would work out the way God wants them to, that they can stay strong.
Thank you, Richard, for sharing that. Okay, I think we'll, Norman Swantz here.
I want to thank you all for praying for me. It's struggling for me to hold still. And my wife will attest to that, but anyhow. And as far as my wife and her operation earlier in the week, why doctors couldn't agree. The family doctor said go ahead, and the specialist said nothing doing. So there was nothing doing.
Thank you, Norman, for sharing that. I guess that's good news in a way. I mean, I don't know, but as far as you, Norman, another 6 to 9 months, you'll feel a lot better with your arm. That's very encouraging, I know. Okay, I think I'll... We have... I'm sorry, I can't... Remember your Marvin?
No, it's
Don. Don, yeah, okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, you're, I know you're Joe Beachy's son. Nobody to introduce you, I guess, so welcome here this morning, and I'm sure you were here to visit your folks, so yeah, I don't guess you have an update on them or anything, or don't want to put you on the spot either. Yeah, actually, he needs the mic, so.
Yeah, thank you, John. Yeah, my name is Don, and my wife Doris with me. We're here spending some time with my parents, Joe and Mary, and I stopped by this morning to make sure Mom was able to watch this morning, so they're able to join you this way. Doing as well as they, I think Mom's continues to improve a bit since her most recent mini stroke. So thank you for your support for them, and continue to pray for them, visit them when you have an opportunity.
Thank you, Don. I'm sure it means a lot to them if you come to visit them too. So, okay, I think we'll have a time of prayer. I'm going to ask you all to stand, and then I'll just pray for these needs here. And our month missionaries for the month are Lloyd and Joyce as well, so I'll be remembering them. And so let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for again another time that we can come together and to worship you and to just corporately pray and worship you. Father, we are blessed to be able to do that, and I thank you for the church body here this morning. And I pray this morning for Lloyd and Joyce, as there are missionaries for the month, and I just lift them up to you and pray that you would bless them in their work. And we know it gets kind of tough at times, and I just lift them up to you this morning. Give them grace to do your work. And also pray for Ellie and the need there that she has. I just pray for her physical needs there, that that could be healed and that you would do that for her. Also for the need of a couple, I just pray that you would remind someone of that. Pray your Spirit, Holy Spirit, would prompt someone to move and to honor that call. And so I pray that someone would be able to do that and help the ministry there. And we know they're doing a good work, but they need help. And so, God, I pray that you would move someone in that direction. Also pray for Marv's family as they are going to be traveling to to here to come this weekend, I guess, and just pray that you would be with them, grant them safety and protection. And I pray especially for Emma here that you would just give her strength, that she would be able to enjoy the trip. Pray for physical strength and that she would feel good and that this trip would not be too much for her, but just give her that strength that she needs. And just pray you would surround them and bless them on this trip, that you would make, that things could turn out well. And I guess that the plane connections would all make and that things would work out. We just commit that to you this morning. Pray too for Wilford Beachy and Richard's brother here. Pray that as things go on there, Father, we don't know, I don't know a lot of detail on that, but God, I know you do. You know the whole being there, and I just pray you would give him healing, give him strength as what is he needs there, and as the chemo has been started, and that things would work out there, and that you would give healing. Also, think of Debbie this morning. I just lift her up to you and pray that as they move ahead with toward trying to get chemo started and just with all the things that they need to do to get that, some are frustrations. I pray you would give grace to them, and I pray you'd guide the doctors and that things could be sped along, I guess, and I just lift her up to you and pray for Barry too, that as he walks alongside her, and would you bless them and the family, the children, and we lift them up to you this morning. So we're grateful again for your love and your grace, and I just thank you, Father, that we can be here to worship you. And I just commit this all to you and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, I'll ask for Kenton to come to read the scripture.
I've been asked to read Psalm 100, if you would like to turn with me there. And I'll be reading from the ESV. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Thank you, Kenton, for reading the scripture. And Marv, if you're ready to go, let's pray. God, we thank you for Marv this morning. And I pray, Lord, you would just gird him with your strength and your love this morning. Father, give him what he needs to unction to bring your word. Help us, Lord, to have open hearts and minds to receive your word. And I pray for your holy anointing on this brother. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, I bring greetings in the name of Jesus Christ, our brother. So it's a wonderful thing to know the Lord. Floyd and Charlene are at Cornerstone this morning, actually. They she may be lonely. There's a baptism there this morning that Floyd Helmuth was asked to participate in by the the one being baptized, and so he consented to do that. And Wendell is in Virginia this morning, so I want to thank you for being here. I saw Don and Doris walk in, and so I give you my greetings, and it's good to see your faces. As I think about this scripture in Psalm 100, I would like to look at serving the Lord with gladness. And I remember my brother-in-law would say, you know, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. He said, well, just make a happy racket. If you can't sing, make a happy racket. Well, it's that seems a little contemporary, maybe, right? But it is. We do make a happy racket sometimes. But to shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth, how often do you do that? Do you shout for joy, or do you just, I'm joyful? So, anyway, let me pray again. Father, I pray that you would bless this service, and I do ask for your anointing. And as we look together into your word, and as we think about serving you with gladness, there are times we acknowledge that it doesn't feel so glad. And so, Lord, give us the endurance. Yeah, and that song, we'll work till you come. Lord, give us that resolve again today in Jesus' name. Amen. So I was blessed when I read this latest Destinations Near and Far. Who else might have read this? Oh, a number of hands. Okay. And I thought, wow, there's a number of different articles in here. And I don't know, the Lord spoke to me through it that people that are serving him in various places, it seemed like they were experiencing the joy of the Lord. Is what it felt like to me when I was reading it. I was challenged by that again, and they were noticing how God was using them and how God was ministering and moving. But there are times we don't see that happen. So then it's a little harder sometimes to serve the Lord with gladness, and we keep praying for Lord, you know, let me see something. We want to see some of the work, the fruit of our labors. And I thank God that we can, but we don't always see that. But we need to be faithful in those times as well. And so that was just speaking to me that how do we serve the Lord? Are we willing to surrender it all to the Lord? And then our Sunday school lesson last Sunday spoke to me again. And it's like, you know, how do we... And when we look at that, it's like this, I'm thinking the song, this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. And so our citizenship, you know, is really in heaven. And so we look for that, and we're working till then. So I want to serve the Lord with gladness. I want you to serve the Lord with gladness. And I believe in being truthful, because life isn't always fun. Like I mentioned, it's not always easy. And we do face disappointments. That we face things that are out of our control, things that we cannot change. And we have to go with what the Lord allows us to face. Yet we can choose, I believe, to serve the Lord with gladness. So I just want to encourage myself, and I guess each of us this morning, to do that. I think as a whole, I'm an optimist. And my boys would say, Dad, how long is this going to take? And I say, well, it'll take about 4 hours to get this done. And they say, well, no, Dad, it's probably going to take about 10 hours. I don't know if it was quite that much. And so usually it was somewhere right in the middle. So, but being an optimist can be a good thing, I guess. But it's, I thought about, I was looking at a video or a video of a person trying to put a big couch in a little car. They were optimists, but they were not realists. And because I'd come across this, a saying. Let me see. I wrote it down. And you've heard that phrase: one man's junk is another man's treasure, right? Okay. And so I was, I'm going to read. Someone put a huge sofa out by the curb for the trash collectors to pick up. Since it was in good shape, many motorists slowed down for a look. But when they saw how enormous it was, they'd leave. Eventually, a compact car pulled up and two men got out. This I've got to see, I thought. They removed the cushions, turned the sofa upside down, and shook it hard. Then they picked up all the coins that tumbled out and drove off. Okay. Right, well, Sometimes, I like some humor, right? And so I was looking, well, could I find a picture of a car with a sofa on top? But I thought, well, that'd be a little misleading. And so I just kind of verbally gave you that misleading. But sometimes God needs to shake us upside down a bit to rattle out some good things. And when we face discouragements or things that look impossible, God still uses those things in our lives. And he helps us find those coins, you might say, or find something that he wants to use. And so I want to encourage us. All right, well, when I think about, and I've had a discussion recently with someone who was sharing, and I'm not going to say who it was. You'd probably know this person. And it was like, well, how do I trust the Lord when I don't know what he may ask me to do? Have you ever had that? Have you ever thought that? Can you be honest enough to raise your hand? Yeah, it's like, well, I don't know if I want to trust God, if I want to do everything God asks me to do. Because it does take trust to do that. And there's a truthful side to that, but there's also a false side, because God does sometimes ask us to do things that we don't want to do. And then when we do them out of obedience, because we love the Lord, there comes a gladness and a joy with that. There comes a learning. There comes a, again, trusting. But then there's also, I think, a very real aspect where Satan tries to make us believe that and tells us that God is not a good God, because he will probably ask you to do something you don't want to do. And so there's a balance in that, because sometimes God does ask us to do some things that we don't really want to do in our flesh. But if he has called us to do those things, then we will be glad if we do them. He will give us the strength. But you understand also the wrestling when Satan tries to make us feel like God is not good. And that's a lie. God is good. And so I don't want people to give in to that temptation of not being willing to surrender because of fear. Because God is a good God. God wants what's best for his kingdom and what's best for us. And so I was challenged by those prayer requests, Hannah Fern. You know, it's like, would God call me to go, you know, to a place like that? Well, right now I don't feel like God would call me. But there have been times when God has called me and asked me to do things that I wasn't so sure about. And so we can trust God. So he is our Heavenly Father. So I'm going to turn to actually, I've got it printed out. It's in Luke chapter 11, verse 11 to 13. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? When we think about asking God for things, he is willing to give us good things. I mean, the Holy Spirit. He doesn't always give us exactly what we want, but he gives us wonderful blessings. He gives us the Holy Spirit when he starts out, you know, talking about physical food, how God is good in that area, and how that the Holy Spirit is given to those who ask. He wants to give good things to his children. So then when I think about the other side, again, when I think about Satan trying to discourage people and sometimes us in not knowing exactly where God is going to lead us, and if we go down this road we feel him calling us to, we don't know the answers. I thought about Egypt being a symbol many times of sin, because God brought them out of that into the promised land. It's a parallel. It's not that I'm saying that Egypt as a country is sin. Okay, you understand. But in the Bible, in the Old Testament specifically, Egypt is often portrayed as a type of sin or Satan, because God did not want his people to stay there. He wanted to lead them out. And so I'm going to read Exodus chapter 1, verse 8 to 14. And Satan is a cruel or a bitter taskmaster. And his goal, we read in the New Testament in John 10, verse 10, that Satan's goal is to steal and to kill and destroy. But God has come to give us abundant life. Okay, I'm going to turn to Exodus and chapter 1, starting at verse 8. Spiritually speaking, if we continue to refuse to go where God leads us, then we do open a door for Satan to work in our lives. And so we don't want to do that, but we just need to recognize that there are bitter things that God wants to deliver us from. Exodus 1, starting at verse 8. Then a new king, who did not know about Joseph, came to power in Egypt. "Look," he said to his people, "the Israelites have become much too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous, and if war breaks out, will join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country." So they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labor, and they built Pithom and Ramses as store cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites and worked them ruthlessly. They made their lives bitter with hard labor in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. In all their hard labor, the Egyptians used them ruthlessly. I'm going to stop there because this is not the story I'm looking to expound on. But thinking about how the Egyptians used and treated the Israelites who had come there because of Joseph being sold into slavery by his brothers. And we'll say, well, will we blame his brothers for all this hard work that eventually came on the Israelites? Well, God had a purpose for having them there, but then it was God's intention then to also bring them out and to bring them to a new place. And so the Israelites were slaves now. It says that they worked with brick, that labored in brick and mortar, and they built at least these two cities that were used to store all, I'm assuming, grain. I don't know, they're store cities. And so I'm assuming they built these cities with bricks. That's my assumption. And that would be a lot of work. So as I think about the parallel spiritually, if Satan is our taskmaster, he will also treat us ruthlessly. So how do we come out from under that? It's by following the Lord. And when the Lord led them out of Egypt, they went. But it wasn't all easy. When the Lord saves us from our sin, it's not always going to be easy. And a number of those songs that you were singing, Mel, this morning spoke to that. But I also recognized a number of times where it talked about rest. The Lord also gives rest to those who serve him, those who follow him. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you think God grades your service to him? Where you are in life right now, what do you think? How would God grade you if he was a school teacher on a test? How would God grade you as far as your service to him? And I'm not wanting an answer. I just want us to think about that. Are we being faithful to the Lord? Are you joyful or are you reluctant? Are you happy where you are, or are you feeling like God is maybe getting ready to do something else in your life. You know, where are you? Are you willing? Are you a sojourner here? I mean, can you leave a job or a house and do something different if God asks, or are you too tied down to even think about that? So I'm just giving some questions, because God has brought me through some of those times. And I had to struggle with those things. And I just want to share with you from my own experience that when God moves us in a different direction, He also gives us the grace and the joy as we do it. And so I don't want us to get so tied down with anything that we cannot leave it if God asks us to. So that's a admonition, I guess. As an optimist, I would, if someone would shoot at me, I would rather be almost hit than almost missed. That makes sense? I like humor too. Okay. Because usually when you think hit, you think it's, ooh, we got hit. No, I'd rather be almost hit. That means you're not quite hit. Okay. But can God, he doesn't shoot at us. Okay. But can God ask us to do things that feel like we're almost hit or almost missed? I mean, how jumpy are we, so to speak? I mean, are we willing again to be obedient? Are we willing to say, yes, Lord, I'm yours. You're my Lord, and I will surrender. I will obey you in all things. The challenges that I just had recently in that gladness spoke to me. And I feel like I'm a pretty glad person, serving the Lord with gladness, but I'm not necessarily that kind of, I don't know if I have that kind of personality every day, because things can get mundane at times as well. But God is worthy to be praised, and I will serve the Lord with gladness. Most of you know my story, and I remember the day when God asked me if I'd give up my job, and I thought right away, well, the Lord will provide. Yes, I'll give it up. But when He asked if I'd give up my home, I was a little more protective of my home than my job, and I wasn't willing. And I was thinking about that again. Why wasn't I willing to give up my home? Because it wasn't the house. I knew it was the location. I knew it was the deer and the turkeys, and I just thought it was about the best place a person could live. So my ambitions and my desires at that point kind of came in, well, it did come in opposition with what God was asking of me. Was I willing to lay down some of the things that I thought were important? And I discovered that I had a problem with wanting my things more than God's things. And so I had to surrender that. And I wanted to serve the Lord. I wanted to obey the Lord. I wanted to give up my home, but I wasn't willing. How could I be made willing? And I remember praying. I said, Lord, if you make me willing, I'll give it up. And many of you might remember that was on a Friday. And by Monday, I thought, what's so hard about giving this up? And I knew that God had done that. I allowed God, I wanted God to do a work in my life. But my own emotions weren't willing. But I wanted to be. I was trying to be honest with God. So God used those things and changed my plans. And I thought about David because I was reading that in my devotions, and actually our small group, I shared a little bit about that, because he wanted to make a house for the Lord, a temple. And God said no. So now all of a sudden the tables seem turned, because he wanted to do something for God and God says, no, I don't want you to do this. And it's like, really? Would God do that for me? I mean, I want to do this for God, and if God says no, would I obey? And David didn't understand right away, but then when Nathan told him that because he had been a man of war, and I don't know all the reasons for that, but I think God wanted a name for his temple from a peaceful man, because there was something about that to portray to the nations and to the world about the God of Israel. Even though God had put David in that position to conquer and to be a fighting man. And God had done that. Yet it was Solomon. So trying to think how much time I want to spend reading from the Word. But David was willing to surrender even that. David was willing to surrender even that, and it didn't make him bitter. In fact, he laid aside gold and silver and bronze and precious stones and all kinds of things. He laid aside wood. He gathered them. He provided for them. I mean, we're talking half a trainload of stuff, weight-wise. I mean, it was enormous. And he provided all these things for Solomon. He provided the blueprints for the temple and how much gold to go into every article that was to be made for the work in the temple. All those things David worked through, and the Lord had given him insight into that. The Holy Spirit had. And so he helped his son Solomon be able to do the work, and he encouraged his son to do the work when God didn't allow him himself to do it. And so I thought, you know, that takes some surrender too on that part. When God asks us to do something differently than what we might wish to do, even when we think it's for the Lord. He was willing, David was willing to set that aside and say, okay, I will provide this for Solomon to do it. And he was not a bitter man. I mean, he was a man who was praising the Lord with the others. And so he was leading that. And so I appreciated that. It reminds me of a man who was on I don't know if it was a church committee or not, but it was something that went against, when they voted on it, it went against him. I think it might have been, maybe it was a roofing or something. I don't remember what it was. And so when they did it, he was the first person there to help tear it off and to redo it in a different way than he had preferred to do it. And they said, why are you doing that? And he says, because we decided to do it this way. And so he was willing to give up his agenda to go along with the majority in that case. And I don't know if that's a very good analogy for David. But if God asks us to do something, many times we think that maybe do we really want to do it? What if God asked me to go to Afghanistan? You know, would God do that? You know, would I be willing to go? Well, what if God, you know, what if I'd want to do something for the Lord and he says no? Well, just surrender. Do it the Lord's way. There's really no better place to be than in the center of God's will. You know that. I remember a man from a place where I used to live. I'm not going to share where it was, but I've seen tears and weeping because he refused to surrender to God's call. And he felt responsible for letting down not only God, but many other people as well. And I encouraged him. I says, but if you surrender to the Lord now, it's almost like those, you know, coins that were shaken out of a couch. I said, if you surrender to the Lord now, God can redeem much of what you've not done in the past. But he still wasn't willing to surrender. And I had to think, wow. He had the sorrow that Judas had. He wanted to do what was right, but he didn't have the resolve to actually follow through with it. And I couldn't give him that resolve. I wanted to. I couldn't do it. I couldn't give it to him. He didn't want it. He didn't want to do what God had asked him to do. It brought weeping. It brought tears. And yet, to my knowledge, he's still living that way. if only he had been willing to surrender his life to the Lord, the difference it could have made in blessing God's kingdom work, I don't know where God would have taken that and how God would have used it. Don't waste your life in disobeying God. Because God will give you a joy in it. And he has done that for me. And so if God has called you to work a wealthy job where you make a lot of money, if that's where the Lord wants you, then serve him there with joy. Because God needs money too. He doesn't need money. You know what I'm saying? He wants money to be sent to other places. If God wants you to live and to work at a job that barely gets you by, but you know that's where the Lord wants you because you are to be a witness there, then serve the Lord there with joy. If you know, it doesn't matter, because this world isn't our home. This is not what we're striving for. I'm laying up things for retirement. It's called HEAVEN, heaven, right? So, and the stock market won't be there. It won't follow you there. So, things that we lay up there for yourselves, treasures in heaven, and rather than just on earth. And I'm not saying we shouldn't do some of that here, because God does want us to look ahead and plan for the future. I believe we're supposed to be good stewards of what God gives us. And so we have to decide what do I need and what do I give away. And so God will help us with that if we seek him. So when I thought about this man that was weeping, there have been many people who have come to a point in life like that, that have surrendered. As a prison chaplain, I've seen it happen many times. Feels like their life was wasted, but they surrendered, and they're thinking, well, you know, some of these men were on death row. Some of these men were never going to get out of prison. Some of these men were looking at 20, 30 years. Don, you've met some of them too. And many of you, Calvin, I'm not sure how many, I don't know how many people you worked with that were in prison for a long time, but you know that God changes lives and it blesses us. And God doesn't endorse their sin from the past, but then I also believe that God doesn't waste them. Where God has led them from, he will often use those things to minister to other people. And God doesn't waste them, and he can shake those coins out of that couch, you know, and make them be a blessing. And I think once a person experiences the forgiveness of God, and when he can even share his experiences for the glory of God, then Satan doesn't have that stronghold to hold against us for a secret sin that we just don't want anybody to know. I've heard people share publicly about whether it was pornography that they struggled with, or whether it was lust, or whether it was whatever. Those kind of things will encourage other people. And so I don't think that we should glorify that, but I think we should be willing to share what God would have us share. Because I've seen inmates encouraged the most many times by people who have been in their own shoes, been in prison, and whether they were murderers or thieves or whatever it was, drug dealers, they were able to share how that God set them free and how God has used them. And that's been a source of hope for other inmates. And you and I have experienced hope and encouragement from other people that have shared things, and it wasn't always something they were proud of, but it's something that God uses. People need hope. So, I guess my question, are you willing to use your failures to help others? How can my failures help someone? Don't glorify your failures, but glorify God who delivered you from the failure. And it can help someone else. I'm going to close here. I'm going to look at 1 Peter chapter 4. This comes from a perspective of suffering. Starting at verse 12, 1 Peter chapter 4, starting at verse 12, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you." In other words, people will not insult you for being a Christian unless you stand out to them. And if you stand out to them, then praise the Lord. I mean, not in an obnoxious way, but in a way that glorifies God. All right, let me go back. Verse 15, "If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name." I think I'll stop there with that verse. But being a Christian, as you know, isn't always easy. It's not always glamorous or fun. But I think it should be joyful. I think we should serve the Lord with gladness. And I'm preaching to the choir, maybe, but the choir can learn too, right? So as a pastor, I'm preaching to myself, because my past and some choices that I've made that I believe were surrendering to the Lord's will, those times, unless I remain in that frame of mind where I'm willing to keep surrendering, won't help me today. I need to keep surrendering. And so I needed this message this morning, I believe, but it was a joy just to see the Lord using people, whether it was on the mission field, serving with joy, or people in our community, some of you who are serving the Lord with joy where you are. That's a blessing when you serve the Lord with joy. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let's pray. Father, I am thankful for you being a God who called me. You called me to do things that it took me a while to want to do. And I thank you for the willingness you gave me. I thank you, God, for always being with me. And I thank you for your forgiveness in the times when I've failed. Lord, I just pray that you will continue to give me a willing heart and a grateful heart. Lord, I want to serve you with gladness. And I pray for my brothers and sisters here. Continue, God, to bless their lives as they serve you with gladness. Lord, I don't know your will for each of us. I don't know your will for my future. But I pray that you would help us to be faithful, help us to submit to your lordship, and to be obedient to you, God, because people will notice our lives, and I believe that they will also be encouraged to seek you wholly and fully when they see us doing that. So let us be examples, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. I will turn the time over to the Sunday School Superintendent. May the Lord bless you.
Excuse me. Welcome to our Sunday School Hour. I invite you to, our visitors, to join the class and, just participate as the Lord leads. Excuse me. Our Sunday School, the title of our lesson today is The Believer in the World. Our lesson focus today is to rejoice in being examples of God's workmanship in a world that knows so little peace, kindness, and love. Once again, our Sunday school lesson goes very well with the message that we just heard. Yeah, that's, we are called, we are called to show God's love and his peace and kindness to those around us that don't know him. Our memory selection for today is in Romans 12, 17, and 18. It says, "Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. And if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men." And so we are to do what we can to live peaceably and to show the world around us what it means to love God. The teachers and the superintendent to the basement can be dismissed. I would like to read a passage in Philippians 1, a passage that's suggested in our lesson. Philippians 1, the first 11 verses. It says, "Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making request with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which began a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye are all partakers of my grace. For God is my record, how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve all things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense until the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God." The children can be dismissed to the basement. Here in the first chapter, the first several verses of Philippians, Paul had a deep appreciation for the believers at Philippi. He prayed for them often and thanked God for them every time he did. He prayed with confidence because he knew by experience that they were faithful people who would do what was right. He knew that they would allow God to continue his good work in them. They had supported him in prison as well as in his ministry to the nation. So he prayed that their love would abound yet more and more. That implies that he felt it was abounding already, but of course we can always have more love. He prayed that they would be very careful in their responses, always be sincere in their actions, and giving no cause for any to stumble. Relate the passage to the lesson section that they were God's workmanship, for God was working in them. They were, in their sincerity and righteousness, peacemakers. And they were witnesses who brought God glory because their lives were showcases of his saving and sanctifying work. And I believe that that is our mission here. What God would have us to do is, first of all, to bring him glory, not ourselves, but then also that our lives are showcases. We are to be examples and to show God's saving and sanctifying work. And I know that for myself, that isn't always easy, and I don't always do that as I should. I give into the lie of the devil that the people that I work with, if I show them Jesus, or if I talk to them about Jesus, if I happen to offend them, then these are the people that I have to work with, and I don't want to upset them. And yet, I don't believe, as Marv said earlier, we don't have to be pushy. And yet, if God gives us an opportunity to show the world or to speak to the world about Jesus, then I believe we should do so. And he will give us the grace and the words to do that. And, yeah, how are they going to know that we are Christians if we don't show it by our love? And so God bless you as you study the lesson and you, just talk about the practical ways in our lives that we can show the love of Jesus to the world around us. You are dismissed.